Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Was It Yesterday? Nostalgia in Contemporary Film and Television. Edited by Matthew Leggatt. Narrated by Patrick Lawlor. Publisher's Note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. History in Reverse. Matthew Leggatt. The entirety of our history is now being written at the speed of light, which is to say in nanoseconds, picoseconds, and femtoseconds, whereas the organization of time was previously based on hours and minutes. We no longer live even in a world of seconds. We live in a world of infinitely tiny units of time. Paul Virilio. In spring 2018, as I sat down and began to pen ideas for how to open this book, I was suddenly struck by the uncanny symmetry between the worlds of culture and politics that I was inhabiting at that moment. My partner and I had decided to catch up on The Americans, a Joe Weisberg creation, then in its sixth and final season. We were on the fourth season. For those who aren't familiar with it, The Americans, an FX television show that first aired back in 2013, follows the exploits of two deep cover KGB spies, Elizabeth and Philip Jennings, played by Kerry Russell and Matthew Rhys, and their family, as they attempt to navigate the perils of a job that involves numerous undercover operations, all while trying to maintain the appearance of normality in 1980s America. Much of the plot for season 4 revolves around the couple's attempts to smuggle biological weapons being developed by their U.S. adversaries out of the country and to the Soviet Union. Strange, I thought, given that at that very moment Sergei Skripal, a former Russian counterintelligence operative for the UK government, and his daughter Yulia lay recovering in a hospital some weeks after they had been the target of an attempted murder by shadowy figures in the Kremlin, or so the UK government insisted. That this attack had happened in Salisbury, England, using a military-grade nerve agent in broad daylight some 50 miles away from my quiet hometown on the south coast of England was like something out of a fictional realm. The event, which dominated the UK media for about a week before disappearing, will no doubt be little more than a footnote by the time you hear this. Like so many similar political instances, these events demonstrate the increasing ephemerality of the public memory. As Virilio suggests, history is being written at the speed of light. How could one possibly remember? There were more uncanny similarities to be observed. As Ronald Reagan's rosy cheeks appeared on the television screen in Season 4, Episode 5, giving his March 1983 Strategic Defense Initiative speech, the family in The Americans are often shown gathered round watching the 40th President of the United States address the nation, I was reminded that a Reagan-like imposter currently occupied the White House. In the run-up to the 2016 presidential election, I was struck by Donald Trump's boast in the debates that his corporate tax cuts would be the biggest since Reagan's. Reagan's economic policies may have boosted the economy, but that never translated into increased wages. Figures from the Economic Policy Institute show that the 1980s marked a period in which productivity grew rapidly, but wage growth was stagnant. Indeed, the structural changes to the U.S. economy in the 1980s under Reagan are often cited as the beginning of the neoliberal stripping of wealth from hardworking citizens. Yet Donald Trump's Ronald Reagan was reconfigured, at least in his rhetoric, as a hero of the working class. History was not just being written, but rather rewritten. This is a book about history, or rather, this is a book about time. More specifically, time travel. One might even go as far as to call this a science fiction text. It is no coincidence that cinema has often been called a time machine. While on the international political stage, nostalgia has been wreaking havoc, movies with their action set in other time periods have been booming at the box office. Of the 9 Best Picture Oscar winners between 2011 and 2019, The King's Speech, The Artist, Argo, 12 Years a Slave, Birdman, Spotlight, Moonlight, The Shape of Water, and Green Book, only one was set in the present. Even that movie, Birdman, was a story about memory. Protagonist Riggins's, Michael Keaton's, career is defined by his early role as Birdman, mimicking Keaton's own role as Batman in the late 1980s and early 1990s, and the movie centers on his struggle to escape his past and reinvent himself as a serious actor. Not to say that all of these movies are explicitly about nostalgia, but they do seem to speak of our obsession with the past. If we take Green Book, for example, it is difficult to argue that the movie encourages a longing for the 1960s, given its depiction of the racism and homophobia encountered by Dr. Donald Shirley, Mahershala Ali. But the use of the iconic 1962 Cadillac driven by Tony Lip, Viggo Mortensen, does lend an air of romance to the road trip that is the subject of the movie. Such films often seem to appeal through what one might call the texture of the past. Rather than operate on the narrative level, nostalgia is evoked via the aestheticization of the period setting to which the viewer is transported. Often these aesthetics alone are enough to distort our understanding of history. As Robert Burgoyne has argued, even as we have become increasingly accustomed to and comfortable with the manipulation of film through digital methods, film appears to have acquired more than ever the mantle of meaningfulness and authenticity with relation to the past, not necessarily of accuracy or fidelity to the record, but of meaningfulness understood in terms of emotional and effective truth. Indeed, wrapped up in this is an argument about fidelity to history and authenticity, but as the essays in this collection attest, there's considerably more at stake than just this. Where the movies mentioned before might evoke nostalgia for their periods in a formal sense, a recent flurry of Disney films seems to show the industrial process at its most ruthlessly efficient. When you think about it, it's a great marketing strategy. If you were 10 when Beauty and the Beast, 1991, Aladdin, 1992, or The Lion King, 1994, came out in the early 1990s, there's a good chance that your children, if you had them, might be about 10 when the remakes hit the screens in 2017 and 2019. Your nostalgia becomes the perfect excuse to take your 10-year-old child to the cinema. I have often wondered what the point of the live-action remakes are, given that Disney's 1990s animation techniques don't really age. In fact, the remakes will probably age more rapidly. But given their box office success, it would appear that Disney has found a formula that works. Of course, we can still enjoy this nostalgia. Toy Story 4, 2019, for example, showed that Disney can still create original narratives that mobilize nostalgia to get patrons through the doors, but that ultimately have a heartbeat of their own. But there is a sense that these new old movies are in some way haunted by the ghosts of their originals. Is it possible to watch the new Aladdin movie without comparing Will Smith's performance as the genie unfavorably to Robin Williams's show-stealing work in the original? Likewise, why is it that James Earl Jones reprises his role as Mufasa in the live-action Lion King, whereas other stars like Jeremy Irons, who voiced Scar, are missing? Mufasa's ghostly presence quite literally haunts the movie, perhaps. All of these decisions are talking points for fans who crowd internet fora. And while it's true that Disney's takeover of Lucasfilm in 2012 had many Star Wars fans up in arms, the pull of new old material was just too strong for the franchise's continuation not to be a commercial success. In the introduction to his 2017 work, Retrotopia, published only a week after his death, sociologist Zygmunt Bauman reworks an image of the angel of history that he draws from Walter Benjamin's Thesis on the Philosophy of History, 1940. Interpreting a 1920 print by Paul Klee titled Angelus Novus, New Angel, which he bought in 1921, Benjamin envisions an angel forced backward by the onslaught of history, a storm that irresistibly propels him into the future to which his back is turned, while the pile of debris before him grows skyward. This storm, pronounces Benjamin, is what we call progress. Bauman notes that nearly a century after Klee's painting was made, one would catch the angel of history once more in full flight. Now, however, Bauman imagines the angel in full reverse, the storm blowing this time from the imagined, anticipated, and feared in advance hell of the future towards the paradise of the past. For Bauman, one senses, there was little to recommend the debris of history. Yet it would seem that the past, at least in the public consciousness, has become a haven into which one can escape an increasingly uncertain future. In such circumstances, it might appear easier to go backward than forward. Progress becomes synonymous with reversal. Nostalgia becomes the symptom of a complete loss of faith in what's to come. Similarly, Mark Fisher, writing in 2014, saw the 21st century as a time uniquely predisposed toward nostalgia, a product of the inadequacies of our present and the failed promises of neoliberal capitalism. For Fisher, ours was a moment devoid of the intellectual and cultural creativity of earlier periods like the 1970s and 1980s. And he argued that even the recombinatorial delirium of postmodernism now seemed exhausted. Fisher asked, could it be that neoliberal capitalism's destruction of solidarity and security brought about a compensatory hungering for the well-established and the familiar? Or is it that neoliberal capitalism has gradually but systematically deprived artists of the resources necessary to produce the new, creating an increased tendency to turn out cultural productions that resembled what was already successful? Whereas Bauman saw our nostalgia as something to be wary of because it seemed to mark an end to our belief in progress, Fisher seemed to see in it the ultimate indictment of our present political and cultural movement. So, are we more susceptible to nostalgia today? That's certainly what some scholars have argued. Ryan Lazardi writes that, in today's hyper-mediated world, technological affordances make it easy to create our own playlist past of downloaded vintage video games and DVD box sets of long-forgotten television shows. Fisher also ties our nostalgia to technological shifts. In conditions of digital recall, he laments, loss is itself lost. Just as Michael Dwyer highlights the new technologies of the 1970s and 1980s that were inspiring a younger audience to revisit and nostalgize the America of the 1950s, it would be worth pausing here to note the similarities in how such technology is now shaping a new nostalgia, especially for the 1980s and 1990s, for the Netflix generation. An increase in scholarly interest in this area, as demonstrated in the recently published Netflix Nostalgia, Streaming the Past on Demand, edited by Catherine Pallister, suggests that there is something specific to today's media platforms that have encouraged this move toward a nostalgic culture, and with it, a nostalgic politics. But what to make of this shift is more challenging. For Lazardi, who coins the phrase narcissistic nostalgia to help describe an environment where new technologies have enabled the inclusion, exclusion, and ordering of individual media texts to be played back at any time, often at the cost of the dismissal of collective cultural experiences. We are being exploited by contemporary media to develop individualized pasts that are defined by idealized versions of beloved lost media texts, pumped up with psychic investment to a level of unreality. Thus, nostalgia, particularly when considered as an industry tool, becomes a highly conservative force. Rather than bring us closer to our past, it has a tendency to erase certain histories, often the marginal, replacing these with a cathartic, whitewashed, and sanitized simulacrum that can be used to escape from a collective guilt and responsibility for today's political confrontations. Christine Sprengler, on the other hand, sees a debate between good and bad nostalgia as ultimately somewhat fruitless, because the tendency to assess nostalgia on the basis of its object informs nearly all attempts to evaluate it. Sprengler highlights the changing fortunes of nostalgia in academic criticism over recent decades. In the 1980s and 1990s, she argues, Reagan's use of nostalgia made it difficult for anyone but staunch Republicans to find value in it. One might note Frederick Jameson as the cultural theorist most associated with this more pessimistic understanding of the role of nostalgia in the cultural and political sphere. At the beginning of the 21st century, however, Sprengler notes a shift toward a new, more optimistic engagement with nostalgia in scholarship. She cites Grange, Moran, McDermott, Cook, and Cashman as figures who reevaluated nostalgia during this period. Another more recent example might be Galad Padva, whose 2014 book Queer Nostalgia offers an important contribution to the field. While this volume's focus is firmly on mainstream U.S. film and TV culture, Padva's positive evaluation of the way nostalgia has helped shore up more marginal identity constructions offers a useful counterpoint to the sometimes cynical take on nostalgia found across a number of chapters in this collection, my own included. Whether you believe that the wave of nostalgia we're currently experiencing offers positive hopes for re-engaging with history, or whether you see a warning that our culture is in full retreat from the present, there is evidently much more to nostalgia than just the formation of catchy political slogans or the recycling, remaking, and rebooting of a few old movies and TV series. Nostalgia is an industry. But it is also, as scholars have noted, an amalgam of a complex web of different affects, practices, aesthetics, emotions, and fetishes. This volume is an attempt to work through some of these and to explore how nostalgia has come to dominate today's media, culture, and politics in an effort to assess what this all means for us. Beyond this, on a conceptual level, a collection on nostalgia must touch on issues relating to time, history, and memory, three hugely important touchstones for identity. Many of the questions raised in this volume highlight these touchstones as areas of contestation. As Paul Grange has written, the desire for memory as stable, reassuring, and constant has always been plagued by the fear of its instability and unreliability and its disposition towards fantasy and forgetting. A number of papers in Was It Yesterday? Treat memory as a battleground on which individuals compete with multinational corporations and the movie and TV industries to help shape certain conceptions of history. In this introduction, rather than attempt to set out a clear definition of nostalgia, I opted instead to set the scene and give a little background about what inspired this collection. There are just too many different nostalgias to theorize in such a short introductory note. Instead, the first four chapters in part one of this book are all in some way dedicated to finding a mode of discourse by which we might better explore, define, and frame nostalgia. Thus, in the opening chapter, Jason Sperb brings together a host of competing definitions and ideas of the nostalgia film. He identifies the characteristics of affective, peripheral, representational, and narrative nostalgias before considering the role of identity in the nostalgia film. In Chapter 2, Christine Sprengler begins by considering the theoretical landscape spawned by studies of nostalgia. She argues that the metamodern offers perhaps the clearest understanding of how nostalgia has tended to operate in recent movies, using the examples of La La Land, 2016, Hidden Figures, 2016, and Carol, 2015, as a means to demonstrate the metamodern style. In the third chapter, Daniel Varndell explores an array of filmic moments, focusing particularly on the role the star image plays in evoking various types of nostalgia. For Varndell, these intertextual moments sometimes reveal the aging star as fading, and at other times act as triumphal returns, demonstrating that true star power can overcome the passage of time and the ravages of aging. He also examines the gender dynamic that often seems to energize such moments and our reactions to them. Ross P. Garner's chapter on fan cultures closes this part and moves the debate around nostalgia to material cultures by focusing on merchandise. Garner seeks to redeem nostalgic merchandise, which he argues is often dismissed as an offshoot of consumer exploitation by giant conglomerations, arguing through his concept of mimetic tangible nostalgia that nostalgic commodities offer a bridge between the consumer and the spatial and temporal worlds of their franchises. In Part 2, each chapter effectively draws on the history of their respective periods to unpack the various films and TV series they explore and identify what it means for a movie or show to transport us back to a particular decade. In Chapter 5, Stephen Ryben focuses on the recreation and sentimentalization of 1950s Hollywood in his work on Warren Beatty's evocation of Howard Hughes in Rules Don't Apply, 2016. In Chapter 6, Fran Mason raises questions about why crime texts, particularly American Hustle, 2013, The Nice Guys, 2016, Free Fire, 2016, and Season 2 of Fargo, 2015, return to the 1970s for their action set pieces. For Mason, the 1970s offers a blank canvas, or a temporal free zone, as he calls it, which locates the action beyond the politics of the period. Next, in Chapter 7, Justin Wyatt considers nostalgia from an industry perspective, exploring the different formulas by which nostalgia can be successfully and unsuccessfully marketed to today's audience through the musical reboots of Fame, 2009, Footloose, 2011, and Grease Live, 2016, which have their roots in the late 70s and early to mid-1980s. In Chapter 8, Tracy Mollett goes home to the 1980s in her exploration of Stranger Things. She explores how the show applies the values of today to the America of the 1980s to correct the politics of the period, thus testing the meaning of the idea of going home, both in terms of the show's focus on a missing child wanting to return home, and for the viewers whose nostalgia means that the 1980s feels like going home. Part 3, which contains chapters centered more explicitly on the political implications of nostalgia, opens with Vera Dika's examination of the dialogue between Jordan Peele's 2017 Oscar-winning hit Get Out, and its horror sources. Like those works identified in her earlier and crucial book on nostalgia, Recycled Culture in Contemporary Art and Film, Dika's chapter locates a spirited resistance to the nostalgia of our times in Peele's glances backward in Get Out. Dika argues that for Peele, the use of intertextual references, which might evoke nostalgia on their own, together expose the codes of the horror movie and reconfigure history itself as horrific rather than nostalgic. In Chapter 10, I tackle a different genre by exploring science fiction and nostalgia in Steven Spielberg's Ready Player One, 2018. I use the film as a basis to explore how nostalgia often depoliticizes the past, and thus produces conservative rather than radical texts, even those that might otherwise use progressive ideas and technology in their explorations of the future. In opposition to this, Christina Wilkins explores HBO's Westworld 2016 series in Chapter 11, offering a more upbeat conclusion by arguing that nostalgia in the show operates as a progressive rather than conservative force because it brings about self-actualization. Chapter 12 by Ian Peters follows some of the lines of inquiry put out by this introduction in its analysis of the role that the Cold War has played in television series after September 11, 2001, focusing on The Americans, Deutschland 83, 2015, and Deutschland 86, 2018. Peters shows how different nations, depending on their cultural history, respond differently to Cold War nostalgia deployed in the face of uncertain times and uncertain threats in the 21st century. The final part of the collection contains two essays that stand apart from the others in seeing the contemporary period as no more or less nostalgic than earlier times in film history. Murray Pomerantz offers a personal account of his own nostalgia for a number of films, particularly The Graduate, 1967, to consider the generational nature of nostalgia. He argues that nostalgia films of today often get the past wrong, and he considers how memory operates. In a final flourish, William Rothman argues that nostalgia ain't what it used to be, questioning the premise of the collection as a whole and arguing that today Americans spend less time living in the past than they have historically, highlighting the movies of the 1940s and 1950s as offering overwhelmingly nostalgic experiences. In doing so, he questions whether the films of today could ever be nostalgic objects for future generations in the same way. Let me finish this introduction by thinking again about nostalgia in a personal sense. In Italo Calvino's wonderful little novella, Invisible Cities, Marco Polo tells the inquisitive Kublai Khan of a city he encountered on his travels around the Khan's empire. In Maurilia, the traveler is invited to visit the city and, at the same time, to examine some old postcards that show it as it used to be, the same identical square with a hen in the place of the bus station, a bandstand in the place of the overpass, two young ladies with white parasols in the place of the munitions factory. If the traveler does not wish to disappoint the inhabitants, he must praise the postcard city and prefer it to the present one, though he must be careful to contain his regret at the changes within definite limits, admitting that the magnificence and prosperity of the metropolis Maurilia, when compared to the old provincial Maurilia, cannot compensate for a certain lost grace, which, however, can be appreciated only now in the old postcards, whereas before, when the provincial Maurilia was before one's eyes, one saw absolutely nothing graceful, and would see it even less today if Maurilia had remained unchanged. And in any case, the metropolis has the added attraction that, through what it has become, one can look back with nostalgia at what it was. In this passage, Polo neatly illustrates the value of nostalgia, its power to allow us to reevaluate the present, and its dangers. Indeed, as Polo intimates, one must be careful with nostalgia. While looking backward can help us appreciate a certain beauty and simplicity in the past, there must be a recognition that returning to that past would only reveal the fraudulence of nostalgia. In most cases, nostalgia is the site of harmless whimsy. Our passing regrets at the changes we have witnessed are a way of coping with the turbulent times in which we live. But when we take the time to consider how far we have come, I personally believe that very few would honestly wish to go back in time. When we look back on the past, we do so not just with an affection, but with an understanding that it would be folly to turn back the clock. The expression, to look back through rose-colored glasses, neatly reveals nostalgia's artifice. Hence, nostalgia should never provoke in us a genuine desire to return to the past, because such a romantic vision is always understood as just that, a romance. Today, there is a space, just as there has always been, for the nostalgia film, and with it, a little romance in one's life. Indeed, many of the contributions in this volume demonstrate their authors' passion, reverence, and even adoration for the nostalgic texts that have held our collective interest over the past decade and more. It might seem there can be little harm in indulging wistful fantasies of postcard bygone days now buried beneath the sediment of the ever-shifting present. Today, however, there is not just a space, but a genuine need for cultural artifacts that can mobilize our imagination and inspire us to look forward. Perhaps for this reason, it is vital to understand how nostalgia circulates in our culture. In uncertain times, we must look ahead toward the possible rather than behind toward the catastrophe of history, as Benjamin's angel sees it. Our new catastrophes cannot simply be covered over with the old ones. Part 1. What is nostalgia? 1. Clearing up the haze toward a definition of the nostalgia film genre. Jason Sperb. One moment in the post-World War II drama The Master, 2012, features U.S. soldier Freddie Quell, Joaquin Phoenix, discussing a letter he received from a girl back home, one that caused him to have an intense emotional reaction. Asked by a psychologist to describe his feelings, "I believe I suffered what in your profession you call nostalgia," Freddie says, laughing it off. This nods to the term's almost mythical origin as a clinical term, a doctor's diagnosis for Swiss soldiers experiencing a profound sense of homesickness way back in the 17th century. Given its Swiss roots, Svetlana Boehm notes that the word nostalgia is only pseudo-Greek or nostalgically Greek. Nostalgia. This sequence was an homage to a similar moment in John Huston's documentary Let There Be Light, 1946, also about the trauma of U.S. soldiers struggling to adjust to civilian life after experiencing the horrors of war. But there were important differences. The soldier in the documentary, an African-American man, was provoked into a state of melancholic despair not by a letter, but by a photograph. Upon recalling this episode, the real-life soldier breaks down again in shameful tears. There was always something uniquely nostalgic about the photographic image. Like nostalgia itself, the frame isolates. It blocks off as much about the past as it reveals. The image suggests a moment frozen in time, both powerful and deceptive in what it shows. As Roland Barthes, Hollis Frampton, and others have tried to capture, those images of years gone by permanently wall off from us the past as much as they may also allow us to glimpse its fragments, creating a decisive visualization of the gap between then and now. Writing or speaking, in contrast, creates a greater sense of immediacy, as the reader and or listener is able to visualize in the present what is being described. This was part of the effect of Frampton's Nostalgia, 1971. Narration is present, image is past. Sarah Polley's autobiographical film, Stories We Tell, 2012, operates similarly. The voice of her putative father, Michael Polley, as he reads his account of family events, creates an intimate sense of presence, while the Super 8 footage of those same past moments, both actual home movies and Polley's uncanny recreations, immediately and overwhelmingly conveys a sense of pastness. It's unsurprising that a collective preoccupation with nostalgia increased across the span of the 20th century in direct proportion to the rapidly expanding presence of visual media, such as cinema and television. As Fred Davis noted long ago, popular culture only intensified nostalgia. The ubiquity of older media in recirculation and repackaging meant being in the audible and visible presence of the past. It is one thing to try to recall such times as a hazy abstraction, and quite another to have it, in a way, physically present. As culture became increasingly confronted with its mediated past, fueled in part by the cheap conveniences of endlessly repackaging the same content through various aesthetic forms and technological platforms, it stands to reason that the centrality of nostalgia's power would soon follow. In a thoroughly mediated, globalized, mobilized culture, the image becomes a substitute for home, as in a repository for increasingly collective memories of the past. Davis has noted how the general lack of geographic stability in our modern mobile society suggests that perhaps media products may now serve memory where once houses, streets, and persons did. And yet, while few would question the centrality of nostalgia in media culture today, there remains little in the way of a working genre definition for that most often used term, the nostalgia film. This chapter is an attempt at such a project, to quantify textually what we mean by nostalgic media texts and what's at stake in highlighting it beyond either just reliving reassuring fantasies of days past, or coexisting with that, blocking out the ugly realities of history. The nostalgia film? Specific textual attempts to define what nostalgia might look and sound like have been, like nostalgia itself, powerful and persuasive, but also fragmentary and incomplete. For instance, Alexander Payne's Nebraska, 2013, is obviously a deeply nostalgic film. In some ways, the movie evokes Frederick Jameson's notion of the nostalgia film, a highly stylized vision of a father, played by Bruce Dern, and son, Will Forte, road trip, that knowingly equates some notion of the past with its cinematic mediation, the vintage Paramount logo, black and white cinematography. But it is also, importantly, a story about nostalgia. Woody, Dern, returns to his hometown, encounters old friends and family, and even visits his eerily abandoned childhood home in an elusive quest to recapture some semblance of a lost past, most directly symbolized by his desire to be allowed to drive again, that great frontier myth of the open road and all its possibilities that defined his post-World War II generation. In this regard, Nebraska attempts to capture a nostalgic journey, narrative, as well as a nostalgic look, black and white 35mm film stock. There remains, too, the question of what possible nostalgic relationships the film itself will evoke in another 30 years, when someone looks back as longingly at 2013 as some now do at the hazily defined era of classical cinema the film's pastiche visually simulates. Finally, the fact that the movie was shot on what will continue to be the increasingly quaint anachronism that is celluloid film suggests another layer of technological nostalgia. In sum, saying Nebraska is a nostalgia film presents as many questions as it does answers. There are, as Rick Altman argued, different ways to conceptualize genre. Through an exhaustive list that includes every possible film in the category, or as a more exclusive group of the best cinematic examples whose textual commonalities collectively define the genre in question. Or we can define it as a relatively stable category with fixed narrative and thematic and iconic elements, semantic, or as a more historically contingent one whose basic genre features are defined more by core ideological meanings that tend to be in dialogue with larger cultural contexts, syntactic. The task of analyzing the nostalgia text from a syntactic perspective has been more thoroughly explored than its textual mechanisms, as demonstrated by Davis's Yearning for Yesterday, Jameson's Postmodernism or the Cultural Logic of Late Capitalism, or Boehm's The Future of Nostalgia. Jameson's use of the phrase nostalgia film is an important and usefully contested point of reference that has permeated countless discussions since. On its own, though, the phrase is vague, particularly as Jameson admits that the word nostalgia is unsatisfactory for his purposes. For a touchstone, the title of my chapter deliberately uses the phrase nostalgia film in a nod to this well-known term, at the risk of unintentionally implying that these ideas do not also apply to possibilities in TV and other mass media, advertising, video games, and so forth. For Jameson, the nostalgia film is a simplified, superficial pastiche of stylistic clichés, conveying pastness by the glossy qualities of the image, which for him evokes a collective, largely conservative vision of an idealized past that is ultimately more approachable in opposition to its double, the messy, at times unknowable contradictions of history. For more on nostalgia, postmodernism, and late capitalism, see also Stuart. Thus, a working demarcation for what might actually define nostalgia as a genre of media remains more abstract, despite there being a working assumption that such a concept already exists. As Christine Sprengler notes, genre labels continue to suggest a degree of coherence and singularity markedly absent from the various ways in which nostalgia's relationship with the cinema can be theorized. From a strictly semantic standpoint, Mark Lesueur's often overlooked essay, Theory No. 5, Anatomy of Nostalgia Films, followed Davis's work by attempting to give shape to the emerging centrality of nostalgia in popular culture by the 1970s. Lesueur's work focused primarily on nostalgia's thematic consequences and visual elements, such as mise en scène. Pam Cook has explored how the language of cinema can evoke nostalgia through the stylistic use of freeze frames, slow, step motion, ellipses, repetition, and other visual means of stopping, preserving, and reversing the flow of time. Richard Dyer has shown how we might use nostalgic pastiche to engage with the history of genre. The concept is perhaps underdefined in part because we tend to think of nostalgia as an effect, a byproduct of media consumption, as often as an inherent textual feature. Affective, peripheral, representational, and narrative nostalgias. Generally, we can distinguish at least four broad types of mediated nostalgia, and the more elusive question of effect may be the best place to start. An affective nostalgia is a form that does not extend directly from any element planned in the text itself and can only be acquired over time. It is not a text necessarily set in the past or targeted toward a melancholic audience, but triggers in the present a yearning for yesterday by virtue of its relationship to some distant audience memory. Davis has written about future nostalgia or planned revivification, how media products will be increasingly conceived with an eye toward their potential nostalgic value in subsequent cycles of consumption after their initial shelf life expires. In a sense, most products' inevitable, often pre-planned state of anachronism is a necessary first component to their lasting value. As an effective experience, for instance, reruns of Saved by the Bell, 1989 through 1993, today, can offer an intensely nostalgic journey for certain generations, despite the fact that there was, we can reasonably presume, no sense of appealing to nostalgia at the time of its production. This contrasts sharply with, say, Freaks and Geeks, 1999, a loosely similar concept about the ups and downs of high school-aged students, but one deliberately set two decades earlier to at least partially capture a nostalgic desire for that time. For my present purposes, I set aside such effective forms of nostalgia, endlessly fascinating and equally infinite to map, as audience reception studies has already shown, and stay confined to more quantifiable, textual components. There are those types of nostalgia that straddle the fine line between purely effective and more explicitly textual forms. For lack of a better term, we can call this peripheral nostalgia. These texts are where nostalgia is clearly one possible source of appeal. Two prominent forms are star vehicles, which can refer to well-known writers or high-profile directors as well as established actors, and franchise properties, which would include sequels, prequels, and reboots, alongside broader nostalgic media brands such as Disney and Pixar. The latest Julia Roberts movie, James Bond epic, or TV show featuring Cedric the Entertainer undoubtedly appeals to those who, either passionately, fans, or more casually, look forward to the reassurances of media's past, which those texts can potentially offer on top of other visceral and narrative pleasures. Here, the nostalgic value of a proven star or durable franchise is clearly evident, thereby negotiating the boundaries between knowingly incorporating that appeal into the text and yet still depending mostly on the affective engagement of the audience to more explicitly articulate that nostalgic value. I am tempted, moreover, to place Dyer's work on genre imitation somewhere in this category of the peripheral. His definition of pastiche, wherein new movies call forth the longer history of pre-existing genre conventions before them, offers up an engagement with, but not necessarily a dependence on, earlier media periods and forms. Meaning, the knowledge of genre history is not essential to the text's resonance, or lack thereof, with contemporary audiences. Of course, the actual degree to which such nostalgia is truly peripheral or possibly intended to the text's appeal is a subjective point open to debate. My point is merely structural. Some stories are not directly about nostalgia in any technological, visual, narrative, or thematic way. Peripheral nostalgia is an unspoken, if generally agreed on, element of the text's appeal, which otherwise offers no direct engagement with such melancholic desires. On that note, we can begin to more directly examine nostalgic modes by distinguishing representational forms from narrative ones. Representational refers to the ways in which, somewhat like Stories We Tell's kitschy 1970s flashbacks, a text might seek to emulate a nostalgic time and place. We can break this down further to highlight period nostalgia, that is, movies, TV shows, and so on, set in the recent or historic past with the conscious intention of appealing to some kind of nostalgia associated with that time. Meanwhile, period pieces are not necessarily the same as those representationally nostalgic media that try to simulate earlier media forms. We can refer to this as simulacric nostalgia, as in not just or even necessarily set in the past, but meant to literally emulate a mediated look from the past. For instance, Nebraska is presumably set in the present day, despite its visual evocation of an earlier film aesthetic. Grand Budapest Hotel's 2014 frame narrative, meanwhile, establishes multiple past time periods, and the film's shifting aspect ratios, 1.37 to 1, 1.85 to 1, and 2.35 to 1, match the common aspect ratios of the corresponding period. Le Sœur's work is an important precedent in this regard, as he made the distinction between surface realism, mise-en-scène, and deliberate archaism, textual simulation of obsolete media, as separate forms of what I am choosing instead to call representational nostalgia. I prefer the word simulacric not only because of its play on simulation, but also its Baudrillardian evocation of an absence of history. Such diverse cases of representational nostalgia must be distinguished from the more common form of narrative nostalgia. Such storylines can be set in either the past or the present, or perhaps most intriguingly in the future. Pixar's Wall-E, 2007, offers a paradoxical nostalgia for our own immediate present 700 years into the future. Narrative nostalgias do not necessarily depend on any particular fan base, franchise connection, historic time period, or simulacric look. Rather, they are simply stories explicitly about nostalgic impulses, just as, oppositely, movies that depend on representational nostalgia do not necessarily concern themselves with overtly nostalgic plots, such as Argo, 2012, The Wolf of Wall Street, 2013, and so on. Some common nostalgic plots might involve one or more of the following. 1. Major life events, such as reunions, weddings, milestones, graduations, or deaths, wherein reflecting on the past and the inevitability of change becomes a central narrative and thematic point. 2. Road trips, vacations, or other forms of homecoming, where there is the assumption or hope that at the end of the journey one will enter into a physical space that is either literally or symbolically associated with an earlier period in one's life, a place often but not always associated with childhood. 3. Time travel, where the journey into the past becomes literal. 4. Return to nature. Here, nature is defined by its opposition to competing notions of society, modernity, civilization, and other concepts that work in some way as a code for the complexities, temporalities, and challenges of everyday modern life from which nostalgic impulses offer an escape. A return to nature would entail not just overtly naturalistic locations, such as sandy beaches, wooded forests, deserts, and whatnot, but also more populated settings, such as small towns or other vaguely frontier-type environments. The nihilistic violence of actual frontiers is more or less nostalgically erased, either by being safely situated in the past, that is, the Western, or omitted entirely. In this context, nature is marked symbolically by its imagined connection to a simpler, more innocent time in the world. The key is that such locations offer the protagonists a reassurance or escape from the realities of the modern world, that is, the present. Nostalgic plots, moreover, involve some element of a repressed memory that coexists, spoken or otherwise, with those same representations of the past. The repressed memory can be relatively insignificant, such as a personally embarrassing anecdote, a secret crush that finally comes to the surface in any number of reunion movies, or the fact that in the Vacation 1983 through 1987 films, the character of Clark Griswold admits he never actually had any fun during his childhood summer road trips and Christmas gatherings past. Or they can be far more significant, such as collective negotiations of war's memory or cultural transition. The reasons for this difficult memory are at the very least dual. For one, the threat that the repressed memory poses for the protagonist provides the narrative with some manner of dramatic conflict to help drive the story beyond the otherwise potentially flabby indulgences of simply reliving the past. The other reason, however, is less narratological and more inherent to the nature of nostalgia itself. Nostalgia's appeal coexists with that since then, the upsetting event that causes one's desire to return to a past moment before that trauma. Thus, these narratives involve a dissatisfaction with the present and, often implied, a fear of the future. The nostalgia text is often about a resolute resistance to these concerns, either through their narrative overcoming, Think of a more conventional time travel story where the present becomes modified by changing the past, a reunion narrative where the two would-be lovers finally achieve happiness together, or some other kind of wish-fulfilling closure, or through its complete disavowal, the period piece that never addresses the present at all, let alone what might have happened in the intervening years to create a desire for such a longing look back. Most genres deal with ideological issues that largely go directly unspoken, of course, but perhaps most of all, the nostalgic text evokes the urgency of that historical question that is its structural absence. What is that repressed memory, the since then, that causes one to be nostalgic to begin with? Although this reactionary nostalgia was not necessarily intended, such historical questions are nonetheless raised by their popular appeal. Today's nostalgic convergence, however, feels like a very different matter. The era of sequels, prequels, and reboots certainly suggests a much more conscious industrial effort to exploit nostalgia's economic potential. More important, that traumatic historical event today is not only less defined, but perhaps absent entirely. While such structuring absences still exist, the terrorist attacks of September 11, 2001, the conflict in the Middle East, nostalgia films are more ubiquitous today, and less tied to any particular time period now that we are overwhelmed with media archives of all kinds that increasingly accumulate artifacts from overlapping historical periods. If nostalgia for audiences once felt akin to something like Swiss homesickness or U.S. melancholia in a time of war, today's mediated version feels more like nostalgia for nostalgia's sake. The completion of nostalgia's ahistorical journey from traumatic antidote to sanitized memory. We can add that figurative and actual reenactments are also a recurring element in nostalgic plots. Sometimes, as with stories we tell, this can simply come in the form of the standard use of flashbacks, perhaps simulacric, where the narrative represents an interpretation of what happened in an earlier moment. Or, as with Woody's final drive down Main Street at the end of Nebraska, reenactments can also appear in the form of characters in the present diegetically recreating moments from the past, either consciously or unconsciously, with the hope of achieving some kind of celebratory or therapeutic end. Such moments are implied in many variations of the aforementioned life event, time travel, and road trip narratives, since all take as their narrative starting point the need to re-inhabit physical or social spaces that embody the past. Finally, many nostalgic period pieces and reunion narratives are marked by the extensive use of popular music from the time. Like the use of mise-en-scène, some of this may simply be an effective form of narrative shorthand, immediately indicating the historical setting for the story without the need for more elaborate explanations. Yet more than simply helping establish the mood of the era, nostalgic music also offers a greater sense of intimacy between past and present, allowing the viewer to feel a more direct engagement with the period in question. If images of the past construct a hermetically sealed time capsule that audiences can observe but never enter, the more abstract presence of sounds from that same time, as mediators of a powerfully collective cultural memory, operate on a different affective level. As with Zero Mustafa's, F. Murray Abraham's, narration in Grand Budapest Hotel, they generate a more intimate feeling of the past, allowing audiences to relive and inhabit the nostalgia in a way, here, that the distancing effect of images, there, do not. At the same time, we should be mindful of how such retro music carries with it the specter of endlessly lucrative soundtracks. For more on the nostalgic recycling of music as commodity, see Bada and Aiken. Old songs, like old movies, thrive on their ability to be infinitely repackaged for new generations, new markets, and new technologies. New cinematic and televisual narratives offer, if nothing else, the chance to reintroduce outdated tunes back into the cycle of consumption. First, as a means to help sell the film or show, and then the soundtrack itself. Here again, after numerous creative detours, the discussion of the nostalgic text finds itself trapped in another dead end of commodity consumption. All of these factors finally move us toward a better understanding of why a certain kind of nostalgia text has been so prominent, the period coming-of-age narrative complete with a soundtrack of classic hits. These stories achieve a dual form of nostalgic address to audiences. Older generations can look back fondly to what they imagine as the simplicity of the good old days, representational nostalgia, while younger generations can relate to the so-called timeless appeal of the poignant challenges in transitioning from childhood innocence to adult responsibility, narrative nostalgia. Older audiences can perhaps forget their own present reality of choices made and not made, and younger ones can find reassurance in the limitless universality of dreaming for the future. Seen through this light, it becomes easier to see why one of the original nostalgia films par excellence, American Graffiti, 1973, became the genre trailblazer it did, or why more recent fare like Freaks and Geeks developed an eventual cult following. American Graffiti's success is not simply the result of a kind of early Reagan-era political fantasy of traveling back to a life of loving 1950s-ness, even though it's technically set in 1962, before the various movements of the 1960s counterculture, the since then, disrupted the beloved normality of Eisenhower's white, heterosexual suburbia, as others have argued, though it was also undoubtedly that. Like many generational touchstones, American Graffiti benefited from conflicting appeals to ideologically contradictory audiences. Better still, this may account for why Back to the Future, 1985, has maintained its popularity as well as, if not better than, any other iconic 1980s Hollywood film. Not only do we have the dual address of the period piece and a coming-of-age narrative, but the film also has that other staple of the nostalgia genre, time travel. The appeal is self-evident, as this device allows character and audience to go back into the fond spaces of yesteryear. But the use of time travel highlights an important paradox, and not just the usual space-time problems associated with that device. The nostalgic desire to return to that idealized past is also ironically about trying to improve that past, just as Marty not only tries to preserve his parents' courtship to save his own existence, but also plays a part in toughening up his father for the eventual betterment of his entire family. This at first suggests a contradiction. If the nostalgic past was imagined to be so perfect, presumably there would be no need to change it. But if we take the appeal of nostalgia to be based at least partly on, as I've been arguing here, the assumption that somewhere things got worse in the intervening years and decades, the since then, it's perfectly logical to assume there would be a nostalgic desire to return to that better time while also changing things just enough to ensure that the subsequent future will no longer be deemed deficient. This paradoxical logic fits a modern advertising-driven consumer culture that rests on the core belief that no matter what condition it may be in, present life can always be much better with the right antidotes. Perhaps the first and most obvious thing to note about contemporary nostalgia, Davis highlighted decades ago, is that it is very big business. The experience of nostalgia is arguably the commodity being sold. Consumers are often less invested in purchasing the actual product and more in somehow reobtaining that elusive yearning for yesterday, which the commodity conceivably mediates for them. Nostalgia is delicate but potent, advertising executive Don Draper, John Hamm, noted in a well-known episode from the first season of Mad Men, 2007, meaning that if the wrong memories of the past are activated, the since then, the product will be worthless. For more on nostalgia and Mad Men, see Spiegel. But if they hit just the right note, Its value is potentially limitless, hence the need to increasingly sanitize nostalgia so that its delicate power can be made more resilient. It is worth noting that Draper's presentation in the sequence explicitly involves using photographs in a sales pitch for the new Carousel Kodak projector. Carousels, meanwhile, are a common nostalgic motif from Grand Budapest Hotel to at least as far back as Twilight Zone's Walking Distance, Season 1, Episode 5, 1959. A circular machine that evokes both childhood and symbolically returning home. Thus, the reference to Mad Men, a show ostensibly about the successes of the modern advertising industry, highlights the other significant aspect of nostalgia's emergent centrality in the post-war period. It is too dependably lucrative to be anything but a dominant force, perhaps as dominant as sex itself in contemporary consumer culture, as a means to sell new products and as an incentive for repackaging older ones. For more on nostalgia and advertising, see Stern. Nostalgia and identity. Like American Graffiti, Back to the Future's appeal was, for some, in returning to the Reagan-esque conservative fantasy of 1950s small-town suburbia. Such texts that look back to a childhood innocence of the 1950s have been read, as Michael Dwyer notes, as a reaction against the subsequent social upheavals of the civil rights, anti-Vietnam War, and feminist movements. Of course, this also prompts the larger question of nostalgia's assumed interdependence with whiteness. Part of nostalgia's modern connotation as an excessive indulgence in only the most reassuring aspects of the past, real or imagined, along with the emergence of modern advertising industries, coincided in the post-war period of economic growth and suburban expansion with issues of white flight from urban spaces and reactions against progressive social upheavals. Although it's too simplistic to say that mainstream nostalgia's appeal is purely reactionary, many of its most popular nostalgic periods, late 19th century Americana in the post-war period, 1950s small-town life in the age of Reagan, the ubiquity of 1980s-era franchises today, seem to fit some of the eras most associated with conservatism, while messier periods of progressive change, such as the civil rights movement, seem to serve as a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.